Oh, good morning, boys and girls. I hope everyone's doing well today. Mr. Than and Mr. Joe are busy getting materials for today's lesson, so I thought I could do a little review for you. Oh, there's a knock at the door. What do that could be? Oh my goodness, it's Bob. How are you doing, Bob? Haven't seen you in a long time. I'm doing fine, Carl. How are your things in your neck of the woods? Just peachy. Hey, Carl, could you do me a favor?
Sure, Bob.
What do you need? Well, I missed last Sunday's lesson because our Wi-Fi wouldn't work at our house, and I couldn't pick up the live stream. So, could you please give me an idea of what was covered last week? I sure would appreciate it. Oh, sure, Bob. It was an exciting lesson. We are learning about the age of the church. We're just beginning a timeline in the New Testament. Wow, Carl. Tell me all about it, if you don't mind. Well, no, I don't mind. How about you, boys and girls? Good. Good. Okay, Bob. Here we go. First, well, we started with the prayer that Miss Ruthann and Mr. Joe do every week. Then after that, Mr. Joe talked about a missionary by the name of Bartolome de Casa. He called him Bart for short. He lived a long time ago in the 1500s. He was to set sail from Spain to the islands known as the West Indies. His job, because he was a Spanish conquistador, or a soldier, was to accompany other Europeans to the New World, and then to take over the people that lived there and make them slaves. Slaves? While this was taking place, Bart has an encounter with Christ and becomes a Christian. Shortly after that, he becomes a missionary. He goes back and frees his slaves, then takes trips in his ship from Spain to the West Indies and back again to speak on human rights. He tries to protect the Indians from oppression because he knows that the true freedom comes only through Christ, Jesus Christ. He becomes known as the Apostle of the Indies. And Mr. Joe said, an apostle is someone who follows Christ. After that missionary story, Mr. Than read a story about one solitary life. It was my job to listen and see if I could answer the questions to figure out just who she was talking about. It's about a man that was born in a small village. He was a child of a peasant woman, not very much money in the family. He worked in the carpenter shop until he was 30, and then 3 years he became a traveling teacher. Teacher? She asked who I thought she was, who I thought it was. Well, I made a guess, but I was not quite correct. So she went on with the story. Finally, I figured out it was Jesus. And she talked a little bit about how the people turned against him. His friends ran away because they were scared. He was caught, turned over to his enemies, then went through a trial and was nailed on a cross between two thieves and died. His executioners, or killers, were gambling for his coat. That was the only property he had. Yeah, after he was dead, he was taken down from the cross and laid in a borrowed grave. But guess what happened?
What?
He arose. Great. Yeah, I bet you know by now, Bob, who I'm talking about. Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Christ, you're right. It's been 19 whole centuries. A century is 100 years. Right now, we are in the 20th century, and Jesus has been the centerpiece of the human race all the time. Mr. Thin said, "My goodness, I think how long he has reigned. No one has affected life on earth as powerfully as that one solitary life, Jesus Christ." "My goodness, Carl, that's a great story. It's nice to know that Jesus is alive." "Yes, that's right, Bob." "Well now, you've got my attention, Carl. What else did Miss Ruth Ann and Mr. Joe talk about?" "Well, Mr. Joe had me explain about the Great Commission. That was in the book of Matthew when Jesus tells his followers to go and to make disciples of all nations, and that he will be with us until the end of the age." "Oh, that's awesome. But I have a question for you. What does he mean when he tells his followers to go?" "Sure. Are you asking me what a follower is, Bob?" "Oh, yes. I want this cleared up in my head, Carl. Go ahead. Tell me again, please." "A follower of Jesus is someone who admits there is a sinner. They are a sinner. They also repent of their sins. That means they turn their lives around, don't want to sin anymore, and they ask Jesus to come into their life to be their Lord and Savior. Then they live, he lives for them. Then they live for him and claim him as their coming king." "Okay, so that's what a follower is." "Yes, a follower and a disciple are the same thing." "Oh, okay, great. Thank you. What else did you guys talk about?" "Well, Mr. Joe had me talk about the Pentecost. That's where the Holy Spirit comes in the church like a mighty wind or a fire. He's very powerful, and the believers have him living on the inside of them." "That's great, Carl. I love this explanation. Great job. What else, but what was the next thing he talked about?" "Well, we talked about the church, and that's when the people learned to speak in different languages. As the Holy Spirit came upon them, they went out and traveled to different cities and countries and began to tell people about Jesus in their own native language." "You're right. Then, Carl, the Holy Spirit must be very powerful to have people speak in different dialects and languages so that they could go out and to do God's work." "Yes, you're right, Bob. The Holy Spirit is very powerful. The last thing we talked about then, Bob, was the wedding supper, where Christ, the Lamb, is the groom, and the bride will be all the believers. And when Christ comes again, there will be a wedding ceremony, and it will take place in heaven." "Heaven? What a glorious time that will be, Carl. We have a lot to look forward to. Thanks for sharing this with me. Well, I've got to run. I think Mr. Joe and Mr. Sam will be coming on soon to tell us about today's lesson. Mr. Sam last week said we're going to talk about the persecution of the church." "That's a big word, persecution." "I know, Bob. Well, I'm sure Mr. Thin and Mr. Joe are going to clear this up for us today as we learn something new about the age of the church. Bye. See ya."
Good morning, boys and girls. This is Mr. Thin and Miss Joe, ready to tackle our lesson today. and it is on the age of persecution of the church. Remember, all believers make up the church. It's not just a building. Persecution is a big word, like Bob said in the review. It means a group of people during this time were abused or tortured for their belief and identity as Christians. This was predicted clear back in John 15:20. And Jesus said, "Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also." So this persecution was already predicted by Jesus. We'll learn about two martyrs today. Their names are Polycarp and Perpetua, who were killed for their religious beliefs. And that's what a martyr is called, someone who's killed for their religious beliefs. They will be our champions in today's lesson. Before we get on to that, though, we want to give a great big thank you to Carl for doing such a great job on review of last week's lesson, where we talked about the beginning stages of the New Testament age of the church. So,
sure do.
Good job. Didn't he do a good job? So proud of him. Well, last week's memory verse, I just want to go over it with you so we can keep it fresh in our mind. And you can continue to practice it, boys and girls, because it was very long. It's in Revelation 7, and it's verses 9 and 10. "After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb.'" So that's your memory verse for last week. And today's Bible reference, you might want to be looking it up as we're going along, is in 1 Peter 4, and it's through 7 through 19. So that's down at the bottom. Our new memory verse will be at the top, and I have it there for you, but I will read it aloud in just a second. So you'll need to be turning to your Bibles, 2 Peter chapter 4. We're going to be reading verses 7 through 19 in a little bit. Our memory verse today is 1 Peter 4:16. So it is in our text that we're reading from the Bible today. "Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter." So that is our Bible memory verse for today. So next we will pray, just like we always do. Then we're going to learn about our missionary from Mr. Joe. And then Mr. Joe will teach us about this week's time period. And when we're all done, we'll wrap it up with a prayer. So here we go, Mr. Joe.
Okay, let's bow our heads in the word of prayer. Lord, just thank you for the opportunity for us to get together today with this lesson again through the media. Just help us to present the message as you want us to, as your will would be carried out. Continue to be with the kids, that they are going to be it's home with our schooling for the rest of the remainder of the year now. So be with them in their lessons, and know that again with their math and science and language arts and different things, reading, whatever they're covering, they need guidance through their parents and maybe somebody outside the family or classmate. Lord, just be with them. Continue to be with Joe and Della and help them in their situation with their health. And continue to be with our offering our church. Just pray that you continue to, like last month, things went well. So I just pray that people would continue to provide their tithe for the month of April. Also be with our pastors, Stephen and Pastor Jim, and that all the Sunday school lessons that are taking place again online. And just help them, Lord, to gain from them. Just give them peace about what they're teaching. Just thank you for your love and for our health. And just know that we have so many families connected with the church, and I really haven't heard of too many cases where somebody has come across the virus and in ill health. But we do have we do have church members, that have family that work in nursing in different places, so continue to watch over them. Just thank you for your love and be with us again the rest of this day. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, our missionary story is not a continuation of last week. It's going to branch off from that. And the missionary is referred to as missionary Gregory. And Gregory, as an infant, his father killed the king of Armenia. And they, and you know, they didn't blame him, obviously, for the death of the king, but some Christian, a Christian family took him in and took him to their home and taught him about Christ. And as a young age, Gregory became to know the Lord, and he felt a longing to go back to Armenia to reach the people there for Christ. So he eventually, as he gets older, goes back to Armenia to again to go back to his homeland and to preach the word about Jesus. And when he gets there, the Armenian officials arrest him, put him in prison, and he's in prison with harsh punishment for 15 years. Now, a lot of you obviously are not even 15 years old, like Riley and Willow, and you know, that would be, you'd still be in jail at your age. So in this case, 15 years is a long time. So he's in, again, he's in prison and is treated cruelly for, because he's a Christian. And then the Armenian king at that time, his sister has a dream about Gregory and dreams that Gregory wants to have the Armenian people no longer persecuted. So the king searches out this Gregory, has him come to his castle, has him come before him, and Gregory prays for the king's health. You know, that doesn't say for sure, but I'm sure that there must have been something about his health. Just think, he was in prison for 15 years, and he goes before the king and doesn't have any regrets. He's not mad. He's not showing showing any aggression towards the king at any point there. He just goes. He says, praying for his health. He shares the gospel with him. Well, the king turns his life around. He no longer wants to persecute the Christians in Armenia, and he makes he makes Gregory the bishop of the churches. So the bishop, like the head honcho, so to speak, or like Pastor Stephen would be of our church, he's the head of the churches. And through this, through the transferring of the king's beliefs and now accepting Jesus, and because of Gregory being a bishop, thousands of Armenians come to know the Lord. Thousands.
Praise the Lord.
So one person made a big difference in the lives of thousands of Armenians. So just think of that again. That, you know, he was abused and he didn't hold any aggression towards the king at all. So that's an amazing situation. All right, we're looking at our...
You know, Mr. Joe, while you're thinking about that, that goes along with what we learned last week about Go and Tell and the Great Commission. Because Gregory, you know, told the king about his beliefs, and the king already knew it, but he reaffirmed it, and the king became a Christian, and then thousands of others did. So the Go and Tell, the Great Commission, is real important, boys and girls. We need to be talking out our mouths about Jesus to our friends, neighbors, and relatives.
So our timeline is looking at the persecution of Christians. Now, persecution is a big word, and that means ill-treating, their treated harshly, they were killed, they were put in prison, all kinds of things were happening to them. As you may think of a situation with Daniel in the lion's den, you know, Daniel was persecuted because of his belief. He was praying, and they said that he's not to be praying, and they put him in prison with the lions, and he survived that situation that was not attacked by the lions at all. So that's an example of persecution. But in our situation here, the people that are persecuted, we're going to be covering, their lives were taken from them. And that's, you know, for them to stand strong through that situation, to know they're going to lose their life and stand strong is an amazing thing. And these Christians, this begins back in, goes from 64 AD to around 313 AD. And the Christians were blamed for the burning of Rome. The Roman king at that time is Nero, and he claims that the Christians started the fire. Well, it doesn't say for sure, but there's a lot of belief that the King Nero actually started the fire himself because he wanted to rebuild Rome. So that was, again, that started in 64, around 64 AD, and they basically, it was the outlawing of Christianity at this point in the Roman Empire. And then we get to Jerusalem. Jerusalem at 70 AD, when Jesus, the Christians in Jerusalem at 70 AD, there was revolting from the Jews at this point because the Romans were coming in and stealing the silver from the Jewish temple and claiming it for their money, basically stealing from them. And this caused a huge revolt. And then General Titus came in, was sent to Jerusalem and destroyed the city. His army came in and just destroyed the city. So we're gonna stop at that point, and then Ms. Ruth Ann's gonna begin with some more parts of the our timeline here with the Christians. So stay tuned as we continue our situation here with our story of Bible lesson.
Hi, boys and girls, we're back again. My part of this lesson is going to be talk about a little bit about the heresies refuted. Heresy is a falsehood. It's not the truth. It's a lie. And so what happened during years 85 through 150, the apologists write to defend their true faith in the one true God. We've talked about that a lot, that there is only one true God. And so they were refuting it and making sure that people understood that it was true. There's only one true God. So we want to remember that and also stand firm in our belief in that as well. Then the next era was the church growth, and that's AD 30 to 300. Remember we talked about last week where they met and the Holy Spirit gave everybody different dialects and languages so they could go out and spread the word and fulfill the Great Commission? Well, that's what's going on with the church growth now. Persecuted Christians, the people that were getting beat up or flogged or basically tortured for their belief, those that were getting persecuted, they stood strong and they told others to keep up the good fight. And they had a great attitude even unto death. So what that did was it made the Christians that were a little bit weaker more strong in their faith and more determined to carry on their faith by telling others about it. So the church is growing now, even in times of persecution. So when we get discouraged and so on, we can still grow. So let's keep that in mind. Now, what we want to do is look at our Bible reference that I talked about to you earlier. It's Peter, 1 Peter, and it's chapter 4, verses 7 through 19. And I'm going to read that now to you. And while I'm reading it, I want you to think about what you hear that Peter is telling believers to do during this time period. Okay, so just keep your listening ears on as I read. And you can follow along in your book too, your Bible. It's 1 Peter chapter 4, and the first verse I'm going to read is verse 7. But the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers, and above all things, have fervent love for one another. Love will cover a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without grumbling. As each one has received a gift, minister it to one another. As good stewards of the manifold grace of God, if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it as with the ability which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified. Through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and the dominion forever and ever. So there's some things we can do. He's already said, boys and girls. Now he's going to talk about a little bit of suffering. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, he is blasphemed, but on your part, he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. Yet, if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this manner. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God, and it begins with us first. What will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Now, if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where all the ungodly and the sinners appear? Where will they appear? Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to Him in doing good as to a faithful Creator. So we've learned a lot about how we can prepare, be hospitable, have a good attitude, know that we are serving God, and what we're doing is not for us, it's for God's glory. And then when we suffer, when people treat us badly for our beliefs, that's okay. They did that with Jesus, and he's our Savior. We understand that. And so it's going to go to God's glory. So just keep that in mind, that what we go through in life might be hard, but it's for God's glory. And we are to be hospitable, take care of one another, minister to each other, hold each other up, pray for one another. There's just a lot of things that we can do. So as you reread this with your mommies and daddies later, think a little bit more about that and break it down in smaller chunks so that you can really start to prepare yourself to be a good eyes, hands, ears, and ears and feet and mouthpiece on earth for Christ. Okay, Mr. Joe is now going to talk to us about our first champion.
Okay, our first champion is Polycarp. He's a leader of a church in Smyrna, which is one of the seven churches whom Apostle John was messaging to at that time. Polycarp actually personally knew John, the Apostle John, and he was, again, a shining example of Christianity at this time. He was his gentleness, his humanity. He was just a really strong leader in the church of Smyrna. And those who worship the gods, the false gods at this time, hated Polycarp. And because of this, they were going to make an example of him. They approached him and said, if you don't renounce your God, if you don't deny your God, we're going to take your life. And they're hoping that he would do that. So the people that he influenced would turn their lives around. Well, if he's denying God, then we're going to deny him too. So he wouldn't fall through with that. He said, I've been alive for 86 years, and of all that time that I've been alive, he has never forsaken me. He's never let me down. He's always been there for me. So I'm not gonna turn against him. So the crowd demanded that Polycarp be burned before on the stake, burned in a pile of wood, and going to burn him alive. And Polycarp's put on a stack of wood, and he started a fire, and the fire is going, and he's praying to God while the fire is going up around him, and the flames never touched him. Now, if you remember Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, they didn't even smell like smoke. They were in a fiery furnace, seven times hotter than it normally was burning. But Polycarp was not consumed by the flames. They went up around him, and the soldiers were upset about this. The officials at this time, so they ended up taking a sword and taking his life that way. So I'm going to demonstrate here how, an example of that actually is a science experiment we used to do when I was teaching science. And this is the supervision of me. I'm an adult, so I can do things like this. But if you're 11, 10, and 9 years old, so don't try this. So I took taken a candle, and I've got a water balloon. And I'm putting the water balloon right over the candle, and it doesn't pop. It's not popping. Look, it's right on the flame. Nothing happens. But look at the bottom of the balloon. It's scorched. It's burned. So just like Polycarp, this balloon survived the heat of the flame. So that's my champion, and Mr. Ruthann's going to move on with our second champion now.
Well, my champion is named Perpetua, And in the year of AD 202, the emperor declared, you know, that Christianity was illegal. So in this new region, it was the city of Carthage, which is now in present day Tanzania, North Africa. And this little young lady lived, and she was a Christian. Her name was Perpetua. She was 22 years old, and she had a baby son. Well, before long, she was in prison because she wouldn't denounce her faith. And four other Christian women were with her, too. Well, while she was in jail, her father came to her and he pleaded with her, Perpetua, please denounce your Christian faith and come free. Please, they're going to kill you. And she wouldn't do it. She would not turn her back on her faith for Christ, even with her wealthy father asking her. So what ended up happening was she gave her baby up to her mother and her brother because she was told that they were going to kill her. So she spent several minutes thinking about it, gave her son to her mother and brother, said she wouldn't denounce Christ, and then they were going to kill him. So she and these other women that were with her got together and prayed and prayed and prayed the whole time. Well, they put the men into a large arena, and the men were attacked by leopards and wild bears and lions and so on. And the women then went in next, and they had a fierce cow out there, and the cow would beat them up. Well, finally, the suffering saints, they were all beat up from this cow and the animals, and the executioner came to kill them. And so he was to behead these women. So on the way, she was being drugged to be beheaded, and she was seeing some of her Christian friends that were grieving on the sidelines, and she was yelling at them, telling them, stay strong in your belief. Don't give up. And so keep your faith. Keep your faith. Well, she said, love one another and don't let up. And then she was executed. Well, the executioner tried to chop her head off. This is pretty barbaric for you little ones, I know, but this is what happened. They beheaded her. Well, they didn't get the job done. The executioner's hand was trembling when he didn't finish the job. And so she guided the sword down. And even though she was in pain, she grabbed his hand and guided the sword down to her throat so he would kill her. So she was a very brave young Christian woman, and we can learn a lot about her as a champion. She took care of her son, but then she knew she was going to her death. But she told her friends, her Christian friends, stay strong. And I think that's what we need to do. So today we're going to review our memory verse. It's 1 Peter 4:16. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. So there you go. She was glorifying God even to death. Now, what enables early Christians to endure some of those horrible things for their faith, for their suffering? And can you make a list this week at home for homework about what you can do to stay strong as a Christian when you face problems? So when you put your thinking caps on and make a list, I'm going to give you two examples. One thing we talked about in class is we can pray. So we know that. So there's one. Another one I think we can do is read the Word, read your Bible. So I'm giving you two ideas, but I want you to come up with a few more with your family, mommy and daddy, your brothers and sisters, a few more things that you can do as a Christian to stay strong when you are being attacked or you don't feel good about what's going on, as according to people talking to you about your faith. Okay, so that's going to be your homework, that and memorizing your memory verse. Let's bow our heads now so we can pray and close this session up, and then we will see you next week. Bow your heads, close your hearts and minds. Quiet your minds, I mean. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for each and every one in this class today. We thank you for what we're learning about the age of the church. And most of all, we thank you for those that have gone before us that have been persecuted for you to give us examples of what we can do and how we should stay strong in our faith. Lead us, guide us, direct us this week, Lord. Give us some ideas on how we can stay faithful, stay strong, like the two Christian champions we learned about today. And then next week, as we learn about what happened as a result of these people withstanding the persecution, the church became a little bit stronger. And then we went into a new era called the Age of Influence. So, Lord, we thank you for what we're learning. We thank you for each and every individual here, Lord. We thank you that we can read your word and understand it. We thank you for this opportunity to have time to learn more about you and your word and what it has to say so we can apply it to our lives so we can go out and do your work. So thank you, God. Protect all of our children this week. Go before them, behind, beside, above, and below them, and protect them. In Jesus' name, I pray. Everybody said, amen. See you next week.